Hello everyone, my name is Nilesh Padke and I work for DHC Software as a group called Incubator, and where we do a lot of different kinds of projects. And recently we have been doing some work in text analytics, and which is what I'm going to describe today, and I'll try to give you some real world examples as well on how we have applied this into the problem of IT management. So before I begin, I just would like to know in the audience, you know, how many of them are students? Okay. So I'm just out of curiosity, I want to know, do you have any kind of machine learning as a subject in taught?
Yeah, finally.
Finally?
Artificial
intelligence is bigger. Okay, that's good. And from the working professionals, just wanted to get a feel of how many of you are actually working on any machine learning technologies in your problem domain. Okay.
In the past, not currently, but in the past.
Okay. Okay, good to know. So let's begin. So today, let's look at the agenda, what I'm going to cover. So I'll briefly talk about what is text analytics and introduce you to some of the challenges that are there in text analytics. I'll also go over some common analytics tasks, what do we need to do if you want to get some of these things going. And then I'll also take up some real world examples, how we have used it in a couple of use cases, where we feel that text analytics is going to help us come up with some real good use cases, features we develop. Okay? So what is text analytics? Okay, so this is the Wikipedia definition I picked up. So it describes that this is a set of linguistic, statistical, machine learning techniques that model and structure information content for business intelligence, exploratory data analysis, research or investigation. So there are a lot of keywords here, a lot of stuff being talked about, and I think this being the last session, many of you might find it very difficult to understand. But a simpler way to look at it is, we want to derive some kind of information from large amount of text data. And if just by intuition, we know that the amount of data which is out there, probably text data is occupies most of it. So we have very little data, in data databases which is more structured. Then there are text information out there. So that's why this area is gaining a lot of traction, and there are a lot of interesting use cases that are coming up in this field, and that's why it's becoming more and more popular. So I would also like to quickly point out some differences in some other terms which are associated with text analytics, but I want to just briefly describe how this is different from, let's say, search. Because in search, you are specifically looking for something, and your main task is to find the things that are relevant to you and discard those which are not relevant. But in text analytics or mining overall, we may not be always looking for something, or we don't know what we are looking for at times. So that is different from a search problem, where we know what we are looking for versus a general data mining problem. The other differentiation I want to make is with data mining, which we have been known to be doing in the past, which has been more around structured data. We have data in databases, in data warehouses. So we collect large amount of data, put them into data warehouses, and do all kinds of analytics and reporting on that. But the prime difference there is it is structured. So everything is defined before, and we pull the data into that form and then run all the analytics on that. So which is the key difference in the text analytics that we'll be looking today, where we'll be primarily looking at text as an unstructured source of data. Okay. That is the key challenge, because it will bring about a lot of interesting things here. So as we move next, quick look at what are the challenges in doing text analytics. So one thing I already mentioned, it is unstructured nature of text. So you are just collecting data from web pages, from document repositories, knowledge management systems. So where people have just written text in free form, and there's no real structure around that. And often those are our data sources where we collect data from, and we want to make some you know, data is an information out of it. So a huge problem in text analytics would be first, how do we put some amount of structure to this whole structured set of data? Again, you know, a common problem, we also know, somebody mentioned it in the previous presentation also, is that, you know, in case of text data, often, you know, we have the same words totally meaning different things. You know, here I went fishing for some sea bass, here, you know, bass is some kind of a fish, and whereas, you know, the bass line of the song is truly, this is called, you know, telling me something about the frequency of, you know, the notes in music, you know. So, another, you know, thing is, you know, there are many ways, you know, to represent similar concepts, you know. So, could be calling it snake shape, like saucer, UFO, you know, mean the same thing, but you could actually put it around in many different ways. So, that's another problem. Visualization, you know, we have lots of, you know, tools for the, you know, classical data mining. We have done, you know, we have these pie charts, bar charts, all those. They did not, you know, fit into this domain. For the problems we are looking at, you know, we may need to have different new visualizations to make inference out of text data. And then, you know, high dimensionality, you know, with hundreds and thousands of features. So this will come, you know, when we discuss this later also, you know, when we try to make some structure out of the unstructured. We get it into some representation where, you know, we might end up with very, very high dimensional data. And, you know, processing data at that scale is itself a challenge.
Okay,
so let's say we have, you know, unstructured data and we want to work on it. So we want to, you know, run our algorithms and things like that. So we need some kind of basic structure, you know. So how do we structure our text so that it becomes, you know, it gets into a form which is usable. So that's the idea behind, you know, saying that what are the different representations of text that we can think of that will help us in doing the analysis. In a better, or, you know, what are algorithms can use as an input. So, you know, roughly we can, you know, call that, you know, there are three levels at which we can think of representing text. One is at a lexical level, one is at a syntactic level, and one is at a semantic level. So what do we mean by this? And let's quickly look at some of these. So text representation at a lexical level. So, you know, at a very, you know, basic, what is text? It is just a sequence of characters, right? So if we just think that terms or the text is nothing but a sequence of characters, we can use that representation to do some, you know, good stuff. For example, you know, in English language, E is the probably, you know, the most occurring character. So if we just do a character count of text, probably, you know, we might, you know, get some kind of these insights that, you know, if a large amount of documents in English, probably is the most often repeated word. And what could be one of the, you know, interesting ways of using that information? If you are in the business of doing compression, data compression, you know, this might not be kind of information that you are useful to do. Okay? So that's one way where you think about text as being a sequence of characters. But the most common thing that we are used to is words. We think of text, the first thing we break down is into words. We also are good at thinking of what are the keywords and try to make some sense out of it. But just by reading a large document, you cannot infer anything. What you try to do is, you know, quickly becomes the key words that are being described in the document and try to, you know, make some meaning out of it. So immediately we say, okay, this document is talking about so and so thing because I could find these key terms in that document. So this is the most common used representation which most of the algorithms also rely upon is zero to words. So there are a lot of, you know, tokenizers available which will take your text, break them down into words, and then give you a form that you can use for your processing. And then, you know, around words there are also these qualities, you know, like there are synonyms, antonyms, those kind of things, which also play a big part, you know, in doing some of your analytics work. So breaking down or rather viewing text as a set of words is the most, you know, natural thing that comes to your mind, and that's most often represented in most of the algorithms as well. The next thing is just, you know, going one step ahead, instead of just looking at one word at a time, think about phrases. What are the most common occurring, you know, sequences of words. Okay, because you know, you might see that you know, some word is occurring you know, frequently, but when you know, you might also have figure out that okay, these two words together or these three words together, you know, bring up you know, more, something more than just you know, looking at one word at a time. Okay, so in text analytics, you know, you would call these as n-grams. So bigram is a combination of two words, a trigram is a combination of three words, and you could choose, you know, how much you want to go further, you know, so that n-gram is you know, what we talk about. So those are kind of phrases that we could use of, you know, when we are doing, when we are representing terms, we are representing text for our processing. And then there is, you know, something called parts of speech tagging, so that, you know, you have, let's say, you know, broken down your text into words, but now you are adding some special meaning to it as well. You know, like whether this word is representing a noun or a pronoun or a verb, because that kind of information when you have along with that word, you know, you could exploit that. You know, for example, you are doing a task of finding out all the key persons being talked about in, you know, a big document. So, you know, if you have that information that so-and-so word is being used as a noun, maybe you know, you use that to infer that. You know, these are my potential words to infer, you know, names out of when I'm looking for persons in, you know, a big piece of text. So, we looked at some representation at lexical level. The next one is syntactic level. So, the way I think of it is, you know, what are the data structures that we can use to, you know, do our text processing? So, you know, we have been used to doing vectors, maps, those kind of things, right? When we want to process a large amount of data, we want to carry out analytics, we need help of data structures. Okay? So, similarly, in case of text analytics, these could be thought of as your data structures that you would need to do text analytics. So vector space model, you know, this is the, I think, you know, it is a very commonly used model, and the highlighted word here is bag of words. So basically you think of text as a sequence of words, not a sequence actually, because sequence implies order. A bag of words is, there is no order, but it's just a collection. So typically, you know, let's say we are doing, what we want to treat as, you know, a document is actually, you know, let's say a vector, and it is, you know, a vector has n number of, you know, points in it, attributes in it. So a document is nothing but a collection of words, the key terms that are there in that document. So you could think of a document being represented as a vector. And that's the vector space model or bag of words kind of model that is often used in a lot of clustering, classification, those kind of algorithms, where you first take the text, convert it into a bag of words or a vector model, and then give that as input to these algorithms. So that's, you know, one kind of infrastructure you have for doing the processing. The another is language models. So, you know, you have this task of maybe understanding, you know, what this text, what language it is. So, you know, if you want to do that, what you would do, because you would have built some kind of knowledge around, you know, these are the templates, if I can identify from text, I can infer that it uses this language. So here, if we talk about what are the probabilities of text, you know, appearing together, and we could use some, you know, that kind of a notation to build some kind of a model which we can use to infer languages. The third one is, you know, pass key. So if, you know, if we have, let's say you use SQL. You know, SQL is also a language, you know, which is structured query language, and it has its own grammar, and you could parse that and build a parse tree out of it. And then once you have that pre-notation, you could use that to generate your query plan and do things like that, right? So think of, you know, plain text as some, you know, text which has some grammar, and if you can parse it and build a tree model, then, you know, you can do something interesting with it. So that's another kind of a data structure available to you. And then the next level is, you know, the semantic level, where, you know, you could tag the text to give it, you know, more meaning. So you, instead of just having a document which is words, you know, you are adding more meaning by doing tagging around it, adding metadata to it, you know, so that could be used to do your processing. Or you could build templates so that, you know, for commonly occurring things, you know, maybe you have to figure out, you know, I got a text and I can map into this regular expression. You know, a most common example would be, think of template as some kind of a regular expression that you are trying to find in text. If you can match that template, you will quickly infer that, okay, this text is talking about so and so thing. because there is a template I built around to identify that piece of information. So template is one way of, you know, quickly identifying, you know, this text is talking about. And then there are ontologies. So ontologies are like, you build your own representations. You know, for example, you are doing something around machine learning, you know, in a machine learning kind of a domain, you might want to say machine learning consists of supervised, unsupervised, supervisor, you know, has different kind of problems, unsupervised. So for your domain, you build some kind of a hierarchy representation of terms, and then use those in your algorithms.
See, domain, understanding the domain would be very important, right? Because that would define the context, right?
Exactly. So that's why, you know,
where
so
would that information come from, as you know, from a random, a very unstructured set of text? How do you, you know, kind of discern the domain?
So the algorithms, let's say that they are there. Those are pretty independent. So, but you know, if I have to make use of something like these are synonyms, these are antonyms, you know, or this. Maybe a word that is used in my domain, you know, is used differently in your domain, right? So an ontology can help that, because in my ontology I would have defined that this word is, you know, a part of this bigger object or something like that.
So a subjective aspect gets assigned to even machine learning of text or analytics or text. The subjective aspect gets assigned automatically by, you know,
by having such kind of a representation.
Yeah. So all these things, all these concepts are like similar, all these concepts are like, I get a sense of natural language. So how are text analytics different from natural language process?
So text analytics is, you know, as I said plainly, you know, think of it as you are trying to derive information from text. Natural language processing is one of the areas that, you know, or one of the techniques which you know, mainly talk about how the words are related to one another, you know, whether where in the sentence they are occurring, you know, what are they meaning. So those kind of semantics associated with natural language, if you are trying to understand, if your problem requires that you know, you are asking me a question and I am building an automated answering system to you, I need to interpret your question, I need to understand whether you are talking about A or B, you know, what are the, that make sense of the, your query. So those kind of tasks will require natural language processing techniques. A clustering task need not be, you know, natural language processing. So it's one class of problems for which you need to use natural language processing techniques. Okay. So what we saw till now was, you know, some kind of bringing some structure to the text which will help us in carrying out some tasks. Okay. So the common tasks, you know, that are there in text analytics, you know, which we'll also be looking at, we are, you know, I have some case studies around, you know, some of the techniques that we have been using to solve our problems. But by doing the things that I talked before, you know, by converting text into some data structures or applying some structure to that, that becomes a way to, you know, process the text, create the input that is necessary to do these kind of tasks. Okay. So first is information extraction. I also, you know, have a slide just explaining each of these, but this is what we will look at. So information extraction mainly, you know, revolves around finding important information contained within text, and it could be, you know, identifying person, location, organization, products, you know, that kind of a thing. Because, you know, if you can get that information out, you could easily, you know, tag that document with that information. You could, you know, if it was a search that you are doing, maybe, you know, once you know these, you can get information around those extracted terms and, you know, give results that are, you know, matching that. So there could be various uses of, you know, extracting those entities out of your text. So that is one area, you know, and then the picture tells, you know, the simple process and how it is done. It's not, you know, complete, but the main steps, you know, take the text, you know, tokenize it, you know, get individual words, then apply, let's say, part of speech tagging, you know, if I'm looking for, you know, this persons or locations, these are mostly they'll be nouns or proper nouns. So, you know, if I have some kind of PO's tags associated with those words, that will be of help. Then I can take out entities. So that is the main flow. We also have one, we have used it in one of our use cases, and I'll explain that later. But that's one common task. Another common task is around document similarity, because this is actually a basis of a lot of problems that you need to solve. So the basic problem here is how do we know whether two documents are similar or not? So we briefly talked about that, representing document as a vector of words. Okay, so that concept is heavily used in this kind of a problem, where first of all, what you see is if you want to find similarity between A and B, okay, if I represent A and B as two points, let's say if I have a 2D space and there are two points, okay, then the distance between the two points is a measure of similarity. Okay? If two points are close enough, they are similar. If they are very far apart, they are not similar. So that's the logic we follow. Then a point is in a 2D space to be a vector of two attributes, x and y. Right? So that's what is being drawn there. And the sign of the angle between the two is determines the similarity. So it's basically finding the distance between the function here is cosine similarity. But to think of it, I've taken a document and created a vector. In 2D, it's like that vector has two points in it. In n dimensional space, so this down below is a 3D representation where there are every document can be said that it has a vector which has three terms. Okay, and then I'm trying to find out how far each is with respect to one another. So the closer they are, the distance function should, the distance value should reduce. Okay, so that's the idea behind document similarity. But as I said, to convert that text into that bag of words representation itself, in itself involves a lot of pre-processing. Okay, so for example, given a document, I localize it. I'll remove all the stop words. Actually, in some cases, for example, if you have a lot of email data, you might have all these to, from, CC, regards, thank you, disclaimers, right? All that happens to jump most of the times. So actually, I should introduce a cleanup even before localization, where in case of emails or things like that, or standard forms you fill out, how the things you don't need, when you actually looking at what you're talking about. So there is cleanup involved in this localization, in this stop word removal. I think we looked, somebody went over stop words also, the most common words, which basically, don't give you out enough information. Common words, about in English language. But, those are stop words, and then, depending on your domain, you could also, introduce stop words. So, for example, in our case, almost other engines we work on, maybe BMC is a very common word, it doesn't add value, because, we are in that company. Anybody writing BMC, doesn't matter. So I'm not going to choose that as my stop word. So depending on your domain, you might want to introduce stop words. Okay, but there's stop word removal, then there is stemming. Again, we discussed, I think, stemming sometime back, trying to get to the base word so that two documents talking, one is talking about running, one says rack run. Okay. They are all talking about the same thing. That's the idea. Right? And then there's TF-IDF, after doing all this, your document from 1,000 words you said that I've got 100 keywords. Right, but among those 100, which are the real ones which you want to consider, the top 10 ones? Okay, the TF-IDF is one technique that you can use to actually collect the most important terms in your document, which you will use in your bag of words. Okay, so then TF-IDF stands for term frequency, inverse document frequency. So, any term that is occurring very frequently in a document is of value, but any term that is occurring frequently across all documents is of lesser value. So that's the inverse document part of it, and the frequency, the frequency of that word representing the document is a term frequency part. So have you looked at document similarity?
Solar
inside uses UC, UCK used to some extent. So we looked at document similarity, and actually that forms the underlying technique that is used, let's say, within clustering. So clustering is a key task. The task here is you have a collection of documents, you want to quickly cluster them into some kind of topics or some groups. Okay, so that's where you use clustering, and to carry out cluster in the, again, it relies on document similarity because you have to form groups of documents that are similar. So we look at how two documents are similar. So we have extended that to say that, you know, documents that are similar to one another form are belonging to one cluster, and those that are far apart would, you know, be represented across different clusters. So that's the underlying technique of document similarity. Take it one step ahead to do document clustering. Okay?
There is this document management software like document.
Yes.
Generally, a lot of pharma companies or legal companies are generally using this software to store that document. So, is this kind of tech? Because the document is growing, they need to do a lot of tagging, and eventually, you know, you can't manage it. Okay. So, will this software eventually, because finally, a document management software is what you need to go and get that particular document when you need it.
Right.
So will this software eventually go away with the document management software, because they are using more intelligent ways of tagging. So you will store this document on a file system, and this machine learning algorithms and tagging will help you to manage your document more efficiently than a document management software, doesn't it?
In a way, you know, you could think of saying that, you know, that EFIS that you may talk about, right? You are trying to, let's say, extract the key terms that represent your document.
Yes.
Okay. You know, if you say that, you know, this document is actually, you know, talking about these three things, so you could index that document, right? And then put that whole document in some cold storage. Okay. Only when your search matches that index forms, you know that I need to go and retrieve that document. Okay. So search engines, you know, use this kind of DM and DM and things like that very frequently. They index those documents so that, you know, for your later searches, you can get will retrieve. And then your old document need not be searched again. Do it faster.
How do you start up with defining the number of clusters and what would be your approach to define that?
So defining the number of clusters is always a challenging task. Then I don't think it's a right or wrong. You know, I think one of our earlier speakers said that, you know, how many functions on that UI they have. They use that as, you know, a way of finding that end. If you don't have a good starting point, I think, you know, one way is go with, you know, a way you could use this, let's say, use 1,000 documents, okay? And roughly you say, you know, I want maybe clusters having 100 documents each. So by starting from this scale, okay, do a first web, and I think that result should drive you, you know, okay, I got two less or two more clusters. Okay, if I find that, okay, I have clusters, then I've got lots of clusters each having one or two documents each. Okay, maybe I need to reduce the number of clusters. So iteratively you could come up with a good key that, you know, matches your
so it should be a human intervention in order to, you know, fine-tune the clusters.
So human intervention, yes. Or some rule based thing, right? You know, you can say that I don't want clusters which are, you know, having one document. Okay, at least give me clusters that are 5-10 documents. So this or itself can iteratively run till it finds a good K which fits your rules. Right? So that should be one way of saying that, you know, I'm trying to automate what the user would have done by doing it repetitively and, you know, applying some rules. So clustering, you know, technique was one where we, you know, want to group together similar documents. The next one is categorization. So clustering, what we saw was a unsupervised class of machine learning where, you know, we didn't have anything historically built up that we have learned over time which we will use later. But this is a case, you know, which is of the type supervised learning, where what we do is we you know, make use of documents that have been tagged before by humans. So let's say, you know, this common example here is of spam mails, right? So where, you know, user marks that this mail is spam, and, you know, the mail provider knows that, okay, I have seen so many users marking these mails as spam, so it has built up a whole training set of documents which users have marked as spam, and the next time any new mail comes, it is going to classify based on the model it built using this history of user tag documents to identify whether this new mail that is coming in is a spam or not. So this supervised class of algorithms, you know, make use of this learning that has happened over, you know, history to build some kind of a model, and then use that model when a new document comes in to make the classification. Okay. So the diagram actually says that you have this learning text, learning data set of text, you use that to create your model, and when new documents come in, use that to make a prediction. So span, no span is one example of that. We have used it in a different setting, which I'll explain in a little bit. But some of the algorithms that do this kind of classification, you know, could be Naive-Rice, both of the machines. And again, this also relies on, you know, some of these also rely on converting your text into this bag of words representation, and then, you know, it takes that as input and then does the, you know, further processing. Another common task, you know, is of text summarization. Okay, so the aim is, you know, you have this huge document and you don't really want to read it completely. Okay, can you give me a short summary of it? Okay. So there are two main approaches. There is what is called selection based, where, you know, you select only parts of the document. And typical examples would be title, another paragraph headers, or, you know, first line of the paragraph. So those could be some ways, you know, to quickly pick out important things that are there in the document and present them. The other is, you know, uses some more involved techniques, you know, kind of does some semantic analysis, representing. So I'm not here now. Looked at those kind of things, but this summarization is also one big, you know, area where text analytics can help to, you know, quickly give a short and a summary of, you know, instead of you having to go over long text. So with that, I'm going to go to some use cases, and before that, if there are any questions, I can take them. Yeah.
So if I have a problem of whenever I do the text and I just this was the article from generator and aspect.
I think creating abstracts would fall under the summarization category. Information extraction is mainly you are looking for some key text in that document. Abstract is kind of, you know, giving you a highlight of the main content of that document. It should fall under the summarization. Okay. So let's get on to our real world use case. So, you know, DHC has, you know, is a practitioner of IT. IT is a, you know, IT management kind of a framework which IT management companies follow, and it has a lot of, you know, under IT there are a lot of subcategories, you know, different spaces that are covered. Incident management happens to be one of them. So incident management is about people raising incidents, you know, tickets, queries, support calls, those kind of things, and how, and the whole life cycle of how those incidents are handled from generation till the resolution. Okay. So as part of incident creation, you know, DMC has protocol already. You know, people use that a lot. Now let's say what the problem is first. So if you look at an incident, it could have hundreds of attributes associated to it. You know, what are your categorization tier 1, 2, 3, or, you know, your product category 1, 2, 3, you know. And then there are lots of other information, like, you know, who is it assigned to, when was it created. So lots of attributes that actually are associated with your incident. Okay. Which if you want to, if you want to create an incident, let's say, you know, you are a service application who is taking a phone call from a customer who is reporting a problem. Just to create an incident in the system for him, you might have to fill 100 form fields. Okay, that itself is a challenging task. A million times, you know, those categories information that you need to fill, you might have 100 different categories to select from, and every time this person is not going to, you know, have to remember, you know, okay, I think this problem should go to this category, and, you know, many times they don't even fill that information. They just report the problem and then, you know, let somebody else do the filling of the category information. Even that happens. And actually, you know, that also delays the solution of the problem, because unless it is categorized, it cannot be assigned to somebody. And if it gets assigned late, it's going to be resolved. So all kinds of problems, you know, do occur just because the form wasn't entered correctly. Okay, so we are trying to come up with an approach where, you know, you do away with, you know, filling out these long forms, and also give the service desk agent actually more power to, you know, try to resolve the incident then and there, instead of, you know, even having to create an incident. Okay, so that's the value proposition we are looking at. And in this case, you know, primarily what we are making use of is the information extraction I talked about. So as the customer is describing a problem, I am picking out key information, you know, who's the person or the customer who is reporting the problem, what asset is he talking about, you know, is it some service that I am supporting, is it some kind of a laptop or some device that he is talking about, or you know, some asset that can be, it can be a server that he is talking about, which I know is an asset, if which I tag in the incident creation itself, I know it will lead to some faster resolution. So those are the key entities that I am looking for. If I can extract that and create the incident, it will probably be able to get resolved faster, because these are the key things that help decide, you know, who this incident should be routed to, or you know, what category it should be assigned. Okay, so I'll so look at the solution here. So as I said, you know, the problem is of entity recognition. If you find the correct entities, then we can show more additional information about that, and that might help to, you know, faster resolution by the support call agent himself, or he might, you know, at least end up creating a ticket which has more information than he would have done, you know, prior to this. Okay, so I'll just give you a quick demo of what we have.
Can you talk about the exact match and fuzzy match that you are showing on the slide?
Yeah, I'm just going to... Some of this mouse has become very unresponsive. Okay. So assume you know you are a service desk operator who is receiving your customer call, okay, and you are going to type what the customer is telling you, okay. So let's say, you know, Chris Jones, you know, is calling me. So as soon as I type Chris J, this fuzzy match actually kicked in and it is telling me, oh, you have two people, you know, maybe called Chris J. I can quickly call Ari, please, Jones, Joanno, Johnson. So that itself, you know, is a value add. You know, you have recognized the right person. Had I just typed Chris and left it, somebody who is working on the problem need to know who are we talking about.
Even the Pizza Hut guys use this kind of techniques.
Sorry?
Even the Pizza Hut guys use these kind of techniques. They will immediately catch you.
So let's say this was the problem description. Okay. So as I am typing, you know, I am getting some kind of help here, saying that, okay, I found one person for this show, that's an exact match, he's of type person. So all I'm showing you here is a person, but in reality, you know, you might get Chris Jones is, you know, he's a developer in this, or you know, he's a, you know, what is his organization, role, everything that you have, you know, from your identity management system, you could extract that information and show it here. You know, I'm giving you SharePoint, you know, probably SharePoint is a service that I'm supporting, but it is called maybe SharePoint 2010, 2017. There are three versions of SharePoint I'm supporting, let's say. So, you know, that might come in as a fuzzy match. Okay? That, okay, what exactly are we talking about? Because if I had left it at that, you know, the person who's solving it would have asked this question. Is he using SharePoint 10, SharePoint 2013, SharePoint 2007? What version is he using? Okay? So, here the person would have actually got a fuzzy match, he would have himself clarified it, saying that, you know, what are you talking about? So here, sorry. Oh yeah, you want to scroll down? It's somehow not this one. This tab. Tab. Anyway, so that fuzzy match has a SharePoint down there.
Does it use a fuzzy logic algorithm for doing that?
Okay.
machine learning algorithm from that. So it is actually making use of, so using as a feature, so it's like a type ahead, as you're typing, you make a call and it gives back the matching results. And it does fuzzy matching. That's what we have used.
So in the pattern, we are using the Rosin.
Yes.
What is the difference between Rosin and the Solar?
Lucene is a search technology, Solar is a product we have.
So underneath Solar, you have Lucene.
Yes.
Okay. So that is. It has built in machine learning algorithm to know who this.
They are, and as they are advancing, they are kind of more document similarities, I guess, if they are coming up with that feature. So they are slowly developing. Primarily, they are a search engine. But they are building more capabilities, and one day, you know, they will be fulfilled machine.
I had read of a case study wherein, you know, they had run Mahu, to do the similar kind of work.
Yes.
And then fed that recommendation to Solar to make it more intelligent.
So Mahu gives you this cluster classification algorithms. Typically, the use case for Mahu is when you have a large collection and a batch kind of a processor, not a real time, because your data lake uses Hadoop and those systems, which work well in a batch kind of a scenario. So it uses those new cluster classification things on Mahu, that's in a batch, you use Mahu. The outcome, if you want, you can always speak to the main field. Depending on what is
using. So it will go in as a text file to improve. Solar
accepts a document. A document can be a JSON or whatever. So it's pretty open. So this is one part where we have extracted the key entities. We are also quickly telling you what are the entities like. We are giving you more information around that. So at the problem entry itself, you know, there are no ambiguities. If there are any, those are corrected. We are also giving some suggestions. You know, so this is the document similarity that I was talking about. Okay, looks like, you know, this problem you are talking about, we have a template for it. You know, maybe this is a VPN problem. Okay, so I have a template around VPN issues. So I can actually, you know, here I'm presenting a list, but what I can give you is, you know, a possible solution. User might say, you know, why don't you try this? If not, then I will just say VPN issue, apply the VPN issue template. If I just say that apply VPN issue template, then all that category and all those things are taken care of you. Okay, you just say apply the VPN issue template and hit that create button, and that's end of it. Okay. So that's how, you know, some of these text analytics, some of this similarity of documents and entity extraction are being used here to, you know, do some kind of intelligent entry of details and also resolution online. The next. Yeah, some of the tools, as I said, we are using Lucene. UIMA is a unstructured information management appliance, or something, I think, or analysis. So it's a very complicated, people call it UIMA. So UIMA is the framework we use. OpenNLP gives you, you know, some kind of named entity recognizers, which we have made use of. Okay. The next case study that I'm going to talk about, so earlier we saw was incident management, where, you know, we looked at how incidents are created till, you know, the whole life cycle of those incidents. Problem management is, you know, one area where, you know, you want to look at what incidents are telling you, what insights you can gain from those incidents. So typical, you know, task of a problem management, within problem management, you know, there's a role called problem manager, and the problem manager, what he has to do is he has to keep a constant look at, you know, what are the incidents that are being reported, what people are complaining about, and are there any patterns that I need to act on, or rather I can take those patterns and, you know, figure out these are the problem areas or these are the hotspots, because most people are reporting this problem. So you are doing some kind of a post-mortem analysis on all the incidents that you have been getting to say that, okay, I see there are a lot of people, you know, talking about VPN issues. So we need to do something about it. So you go to your IT person and say, you know, I got so many incidents around VPN, please correct it. Or, you know, you could go to your product and say that, you know, this feature is not usable. All people are telling you this is the problem. So this is a feedback loop that goes to your different teams. But the problem manager has to constantly keep a watch on, you know, what are the complaints. And it usually this is the manual process. You know, he has to, through his experience only, he can tell, okay, last week also there was this problem, reported, you know. I think from last release it does not come, but you know, this release it has surfaced. So all those kind of things he has to keep track of, only then he can, you know, create those problems or identify those problems and then pass it along. So today this is a very, you know, manual task and depends a lot on the skill of that problem manager. But he needs help, you know, he cannot simply go over with lakhs of tickets or, you know, this incident reported and, you know, come up with this, identify these problems. So for him, you know, there is a, the solution is use text clustering. So take the incidents, okay. As I said, you know, most of the incidents that they don't have a category information field. So I can't really say, you know, give me all category A incidents, because that is the easiest way to determine problems. But in practice, all that information might not be available. So the next thing is, just use the text of the incident. What is the incident talking about? Okay? And try to find incidents that are similar. Okay? So create groups of incidents which are similar, and then the larger groups are your immediate problem areas. Okay? If I get a cluster, you know, which has 1,000 issues in it, okay, then I need to go address it. Okay? So your problem manager is now getting a quick view of what he needs to, you know, report. What are the hotspots? What are the problem areas that are there? Okay?
So, you have been demoed this. So basically these are the, you know, on the top what you see.
So this is an interesting visualization, you know, also requirement, you know, where just looking at this, the size of that, you know, bubble is telling you, you know, go look at this, you know. Okay.
Python. Try Python.
I want to get to the other end. Okay. So in our IT system we get tickets often, you know, people report issues, right? So we ran this on that data, and you know, looks like a lot of people are having problems with their laptop. A lot of people are having, you know, trouble accessing something. Okay. There are a lot of problems in Outlook. There are, you know, a lot of password issues. Okay. So this is kind of giving you an indication, you know, what are the problems that people are talking about, and how, you know, where do you need to invest? Let's say you have two people to solve these problems. You know, go solve this because this looks like a big cluster. If you solve this, it's going to help us. Can I automate this, you know, password problem? Because most people say, no, I forgot my password. So give them a self-service way of collecting their passwords. Right? So you take actions on the problems that you are, you know, most commonly looking at. So that's the use case we have for, you know, a problem manager. And the text clustering kind of a technique is used here to quickly highlight the problem areas. Okay. So why we are here?
Very valuable.
So I just ran this clustering on all the talks that are being, you know, done for Fifth Element. Okay. So, you know, I went to the Fifth Element page you know, all the people who have given their entries, I took the titles of all those topics and ran this clustering on that. So, you know, let's say now, you know, when I'm attending this conference, okay, I'm interested in all real-time, you know, stream processing kind of events. So I can quickly know that, okay, there are five real-time, you know, talks that are covered by some real-time event stream, or even if somebody is interested in Solr, Elasticsearch, he can quickly get to that and he can understand, you know, okay, maybe I know I need to go and attend these topics because there are five, you know, two or three tracks that are running, right? So quickly locate, you know, what is interesting to you. Or, you know, if you want to change your tracks, no, you have some insight. Okay? If you want to have, you know, real time track, maybe take these two groups, merge them and say this is my real time track. So that was one example. Tools, you see, Weka has this, you know, the KBs, that we have used from Weka. This is library we have right now, it's a commercial one, Lingo3G. The visualization you saw was a phone tree visualization. Then we next to the next case study, which is the last one, right? Which is again around incident management. And the problem that we are looking at is, when you raise an incident, again, this is the problem. Somebody is reporting a problem, either over phone. So this is the guy who is taking problems over phone. And she's an analyst who is taking problems over email. So people just fire an email to helpdesk. Helpdesk can send an email saying that something is not working or things like that. So when such problems come in, how are they getting assigned? Again, as I said, categories are one commonly used technique. If a problem is observed, so category, this you should assign. But as I said, categories might be missing, or there might be hundreds of categories, and then the support desk agent has to know that okay, this category, so this should be the assignment. Those kind of problems are there. So what we looked at is, can we use text classification as a technique to solve this problem? So the idea here is, in my system, I have lots of incidents that have been reported in there. They have been assigned to different groups and solved in them. Right? So this becomes my training data. So I'll use this training data to create some kind of a classification model. Okay? So all the past incidents, I know the text of those incidents, I know the assigned group for those. So when a new ticket comes in, I will apply that against the model that I have built using my classifier. Okay? And predict that this ticket should be assigned to this group. Okay? So this assignment problem, as I said, it could take days in some cases. Could actually be automated, or it could at least help the person doing the assignment to take those decisions quickly. So that's our idea behind doing applying text classification, as a technique for the problem of assigning of incidents to the right people. Okay. So I think it's a new incident when it's created and it goes to the server. The server is query, this is the component that we wrote. It's going to query that component and ask what should be the assigned group. And this component is essentially making use of the model we built using the historical tickets, okay, and built that classification model. So this component actually queries that model and says this is a suggested group that this ticket should be assigned to. Then probability that assignment prediction that you do, if it is not correct, there are certain algorithms which also can auto-correct or auto-learn if you tell them you. So that's a feedback loop available for some classification algorithms that we have made use of. But the idea here is we are using text classification as a technique to do the ticket assignment. So that's all I had to cover. If there are any questions, we can take them now. Last talk of the day, I think people are eagerly waiting to get home.
Really?
Yeah.
For the UI, UI MA as a tool for the traffic that you
have. Yes.
For the UI of the for the prototype.
Okay.
Interface, you say which would be
home. It is a home thing. Home thing. It's by that negotiation.
It's based on DC, right?
Yes, sir.
Is it based on G3.js?
It is a JavaScript thing, a JavaScript based library, not G3.js. It's a commercial one.
So when you store the text data into the database after post-processing, do you also have a new sort of store them as is as NoSQL, or do some kind of a structure management as well, like graph or something like that?
Are you talking about a specific problem out of the three or in general?
In general.
Okay. So in general, if you are a search kind of a problem you have at hand, you can go to Elasticsearch. Behind the scenes, you see. Okay. For
indexing
kind of. If search is your main use case, if you are ID based retrieval, hashes kind of, cache is your main requirement. Let's say you go to these Redis or those kind of MongoDB, which are key value stores. You can use those. MongoDB is not Redis is, let's say, a good example of that. MongoDB is a document oriented database, which is good for scale, but not for transactions. So that kind of problem. So depending on what your use case is, you know, you could go to this engine. Within this NoSQL, you have different types of databases: key-value stores, document-oriented, column-oriented. So depending on your use case, you could choose, you know, the appropriate store that you would want to retain this instance.
Do you have a use case design pattern? Because there are so many tools which are available. So, for example, for a particular use case, then these are the stack of technology that you can use to solve that. So is there a similar kind of a use case pattern? Or do you see
the I would say, you know, once you understand the basic techniques available in your hand, like, you know, I told you, Now, you, if you think that, you know, in this use case, what am I trying to do? I'm trying to take the example of problem. I'm trying to identify what are the key problem areas. So with a technique like clustering help, because that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to create a group of documents which are telling me some problem. So I have some set of techniques that are available to me at hand. Depending on my problem, if I can, you know, map that to my use case, that's the way I would, you know, pick up the right thing. Or at least I can try if this is working, if not, then I'll look for some things.
Yes, are you going
one level
above
the
speech to text,
image
speech
recognition, and then? Yes, so I think that's the next step we are looking at. So now we are entering text before somebody is just calling you on phone and then whatever the system does it for you. You don't need a man in the middle. We are looking at it. We don't have graduate or practice yet, but definitely it's at least on the
It's a very generic solution. And you have
to IPI
and what can be
used. So, as I told you, these techniques are very basic. You know, I have applied it to this our domain, but you once you know these techniques, you could apply it to your domain as well. So, that's the core idea, is, you know, introduce it to the technique so that you can take it back and, you know, use it in your domain.